Let's see. Wait, who haven't we seen from yet? Deep Blues are fighting Dank Blues. We are watching that match.
That's going to be a good one.
Alright, where are they at? Where are they at? There we go. Umbreon Monarch.
Beautiful.
It's so funny.
So we're going to watch Umbreon Monarchy?
Yep. For the Deep versus Dank.
Get deeply dank.
I'm very excited to watch this. We get to show how good this team is.
By pitting them against themselves. So let's get some bidding going then.
Oh, all right.
Place your bets.
Let's see how much money I have.
I ain't got nothing.
Right, we'll do 100% payout. 10,000 max bid. 100 minimum bid. Do a bet timer for 6 minutes. Kick that off. So what you're going to do is exclamation point bet, followed by 0 for Deep Blues, 1 for Dank Blues, and then the amount of points that you want to wager, somewhere between 100 and 10,000 points, which should be no one except for maybe me should have anywhere close to 10,000 points.
So, what does it look like going into this? Oh, yo, we have a Tomo versus Kairos matchup first thing.
Yeah, that's going to be a crazy match, too. That's what I'm saying, Jordan. No one should have 10,000 points, which is why it's all encompassing. Oh, the song's pretty sick, though. Is it Love Letter 384? Oh, no, that's just. No, that is it. I had a bunch of new, Ex-Keto music to the queue. I added about another 24 hours worth of songs. About ready to get into the lobby, it seems. And by getting into the lobby, I mean watch the news.
Watch the news. Gets you every time, man.
Every time. Playlist songs. I'll have to get it to you afterwards because it's not a specific playlist. It's three different playlists from Spotify merged into one mega playlist. So I'll send you a message after the tournament of what's all in it. looks like we're about ready to start.
All right, awesome. Let's get this dank show on the road.
Is dank or is it deep?
Deeply dank.
Dankly deep.
I'm trying to see how challenged did the brackets kind of a weird thing. Gotta check something. Okay, I see what it did.
What did it do?
So what it did was it matched up teams based on their point differential. So like Kairos had the lowest point differential, so they're playing against the highest ranked team, which was Tomo, because Tomo was the first seeded team. And they also had the most points.
Well, that's pretty neat.
Yeah. I tried a different way of point differential to stop tiebreakers, and it ended up with this. That's how Dank Blues and Deep Blues ended up playing each other.
Okay.
What a way to start.
Well, hello to you too.
I feel like, in a way, this is kind of a friendly match in the most competitive setting I've ever seen in my life.
Well, it's all on the line here. Is it deep or is it dank?
Some serious bragging rights that are going to be going on here.
Oh, he jumped to the wrong end.
Oops. That is like a typical thing that I would do. I'd be kind of like, oh yeah, no, I did that. Yeah, I meant to do that. That was on purpose.
Very even game. It's almost like they know each other's playstyles.
It's almost like they know exactly what the other team's going to be doing at any given moment.
Interesting. This will be fascinating. It's kind of like playing chess against yourself.
So he's got that Kraken ready, but he's kind of in the face of that sniper. I don't know. I'd be concerned.
Sniper doesn't have a bead on him, though.
And we have FLC, who's just joined us. Welcome.
Oh.
Hello, hello, hello.
Welcome,
what are we doing here?
We are watching Deep Blues.
You should know this. Yes.
Deep Blues
yes,
versus
we are.
Dank Blues.
Very blue game at the moment.
Eiffel 65 would be so proud of us right now.
Oh no, please no. I can't get that stuck in my head right now. No. It happened.
I mean, it happened on stream not that long ago. Me and Mario sang it.
Good God.
Maybe that should be the Tower Control song. Just for no real reason aside from the fact that it apparently triggers Jack.
Oh my God, thank you. Gosh, thank you so much. You're my new favorite person in the whole wide world.
Wait, new?
Oh God.
Well played.
So quick.
Ooh.
I'm
not gonna touch that one. Anyway, yeah, so we've got the
double Kraken
two blues teams. With the, yeah.
Mirroring each
rare
other.
Sight in this, rare sight in this tournament.
I'm just gonna gun it down the street.
I'd argue that Umbre single-handedly got that push for them, getting that two kills off the Rainmaker, popping the Rainmaker, and then grabbing the Rainmaker to go forward.
Yeah, the Kraken definitely coming in handy for that. I always do find it interesting how teams sort of have to adapt to not having those invincibility specials to make their pushes for them. There's, like, Rainmaker quick respawn isn't quite as important because usually your push, like, whereas with tower control, like, a quick respawn push is harder to stop because it's harder to, like, actually stop a push dead. Whereas in Rainmaker, like, once the Rainmaker's dead, it's kind of hard to get moving again. So the quick respawn doesn't help as much with that. So.
Yeah, it's much more map dependent.
Yeah. So,
Oh, I just realized I was watching our own stream again. Damn it, damn.
You know, I thought we'd be done with this once you weren't clipping things anymore.
It's so hard. It's the same size. I made it accidentally the same size. So, 40 seconds left on the clock. I feel like Deep Blues have this. I don't know if this is Deep Blues or Dank Blues.
This is Deep.
We're watching Deep, yeah.
This is very deep.
It's also in the title of the
show. Oh, okay, great.
I mean, he could just be saying that because, like, he's in Deep Blues, even though he's on Dank Blues. You never know.
Yeah, never
this
know.
Is, this is true. They could just be lying to us. I mean, if someone really wanted to tease me, they would just claim that they are a different team playing for BNS and actually not even be in the tournament.
I feel like that's something Pleb would do.
You'd probably still get casted, just because at that point I'm all in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At that point, if you're willing to fuck with us that intensely, we're gonna reward you for it.
So overall, just it was that one strong push that won the game. I think was pretty just close the whole way up until just that one push where Umbre just came in, got a double, popped the Rainmaker, went forward, and that was game.
I was a bit confused for a moment there because Marsh is using vanilla L3, and I was like, hang on, is that two Krakens? No, wait.
One thing I'd like to point out is, did you see how much Dank Blues just wrecked them in KD, but the game was completely even?
Yeah,
the whole
I was
way?
Actually going to say something about, like, it looked as though for most of that game after the big push, like, that one big push was what won the game, obviously, but then, like, before that and after that, there was a lot of. Like, there was a lot of fighting in mid that didn't really go anywhere. I don't know if it was because, Dank Blues? I think it's Dank Blues. Taylor's on Umbre's team, so I'm assuming Taylor's on Deep Blues, not Dank Blues. Anyway. It seemed like a sort of a lack of decisiveness, maybe? That, or perhaps a lack of painting weapons. I didn't actually get to see their comp. Yeah, like, there was. They were getting the kills, but then they weren't making anything of them, whereas Deep Blues managed a solid push off the one sort of opportunity they had, and that was enough for them to win the game. Interesting that they're going with the custom E-Leader as their Kraken weapon on this. Urchin isn't really an E-Leader map to begin with. The beacons are kind of nice, I guess, but I'd argue that you'd want something more like an Octobrush or something like that, or a Grim Range Blaster.
Well,
sorry,
as
not a Grim
Range Blaster. I'm not sure who it is exactly, but I know that he usually plays only E-Leaders or like Chargers. But
are you
I would say
right
on.
Now?
No. the Moon Runes. I would typically go for Splatter Scope on this map. Kelp? I feel like it's a lot stronger, especially if you have the limit of the Kraken, like you said. I would opt out for a Killer Whale because that charge potential is just so quick. You can get some quick snipes on Urchin in particular if you were just going to go with a Charger.
Yeah, like Urchin, it doesn't really have the range advantage for the E-Leader, and on top of that, because of the amount of turf coverage that you need to get down in places that the E-Leader can't necessarily get to that easily either, it's like a lot of the turf, like, in the lower mid area, you're usually wanting something more like a Dynamo or a Slosher to get that turf controlled for you. whereas the E-Leader sort of is stuck in the alleyways a lot of the time. And sure, like, it's very powerful in the alleyways, but it's sort of limited in what it can do. And with tower control, you don't want to be sort of pinned to a certain part of the map. You need to be able to move up sort of point to point as you push the tower further forward.
I really like the cadence going on in this match. It's night and day from what we were saying in the last one, where both teams were kind of cautiously feeling each other out. This one, Dank is really putting on a lot of aggression.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this is pretty amazing, like, just watching Umbreon, like, having to, like, back up and control the hill, and he seems largely to be alone, so it's like, you know, it's where his teammates are, and where they're kind of pushing in different areas, so it's like, this is a really fun matchup to watch right now.
I mean, like, what yeah. me and FLC said before was that, last game, Dank had all the kills. Like, they were just in complete control of the game in terms of KD. They just couldn't make that push on the Rainmaker. Could be because of greed, could be because of just those last-minute kills, but...
Ooh, that's unfortunate. Ooh,
yeah.
That is the problem with the Grimm. The Grimm's a very, very powerful weapon, but it's also very thirsty. You need sizable amount of ink to get those quick kills, and that's sort of why I usually tell people if they're trying to learn the Grimm, the thing to learn is not how to get those kills, it's when to not go for those kills where you do the burst combo, because it takes 50% of your ink, and if you're using that for every single kill, you're going to be sitting recovering ink for a sizable part of the game. Excellent.
Ooh, nice.
That was beautiful.
And yeah, so Umbri is, and always has been, a very defensive player. When he was on my team, Exultance, well, originally Imperius, he was sort of the anchor for the team. Usually we'd have, you know, Sorda and them moving up forward, and he'd just sort of always be alive in the back. Like, he'd, you know...
Like he's doing currently in this game.
Yeah, like he's doing right now.
Yeah, he's demonstrating that,
like, yeah, but then, like, the pushes that have... The Dank Blues have come up with have come off the back of Umbri getting picked off. So it's sort of like, if you sort of rely on Umbri to be that defensive anchor for you and he goes down, then that's not great for you.
Yeah. Another thing about this map in particular is just, like you said before, having that E-Leader. If an E-Leader can't snipe the tower before, let's say, maybe the 70 mark, it becomes very, very difficult for them to get another pick until, like, let's say, the 50 or 40 point. So in a way, it's kind of like taking a risk. You have to hope that E-Leader's positioned properly all the time on the tower. Another reason why it's a weird map. You can see, like, a lot of top snipers, like Power. I'm not going to say I'm a top sniper, but even I'm slowly switching to Chargers. Like splatter scopes in different situational maps as opposed to E-Leader. The meta slowly changing for a lot of
I know like Nike, for example, just drops the E-Leader completely whenever this is in solo queue rotation. Mm-hmm. He just goes CRB or occasionally like Culp or whatever. Actually, this is the first time we've seen Deep Blues with any kind of control here, and you can see that it's a lot more substantial, I guess, than substantial. Not really the right word, but you get the point. it's yeah, sure.
So is Umbri just memeing there? He didn't even pop a killer whale. He just
jumping
on tower.
I just think he was just messing around. I think he knew they were going to get the lead, and he just decided to be rude about it.
Well, that said, the Grimm does have the light depletion, and also fitting a whale in with your sort of Grimm burst bomb and shot rotations is kind of tricky, surprisingly enough. Perhaps you just figured that it's better to have the whale ready for, and you can see it's like already charged after only a few burst bombs. Just having it ready for the defense on these last 20 seconds.
Yeah, that's a fair point, actually. I didn't think about it.
Oh, what the fuck?
Whoa,
was that?
Hey, wow.
That hold one on. Point meme. Oh my god, did you see that?
Oh
tower?
My.
Oh, look at own, this.
Their own team.
Look at this.
Oh no! Oh no! This
is the special kind of lag.
That was like, that was like.
I gotta say.
Fuck yeah, no! That was just some fucking artificial tension right there. This game should be close. Have the tower just teleport 10 points.
Deep Blues better be salty after that win.
I can only imagine the amount of shit talking that's happening right now.
I wouldn't be surprised if all eight of them are in the same VC right now.
Just I would not be surprised.
Yeah, I get the impression there's going to be some hopping back and forth. Yo, guys, what the fuck was that, man?
Yeah. I always do.
Get lighting. Better internet, you scrub.
Fucking hell. Dank blues with the dank routers. Straight from Fisher Price.
Well, no, they're deep in that ocean, you know? No reception.
Yeah, true. Actually, well, I mean, you know, it depends. Like, if they're sort of, like, on a floating platform in the ocean, surely they'd have, like, a satellite connection or something? Because, you know, it should be clear sky. Surely? Then again, then, like...
They aren't in the same VC.
They are in the same VC.
Oh my god.
Oh, aren't. They are not.
Yeah, they are not.
Oh, okay. I thought you said they are.
So,
yeah, I heard are, but then I read chat.
Sorry.
Meanwhile, Umbri's going with the Rapid Pro here. So, again, they're going with the custom E-Leader. Not really sure I agree with that particular choice.
Not on zones.
Not on zones, no.
Because if you're going all the way up with a Kraken on the enemy zone... like to try and create pressure, it means that you're not there to defend. So in the event that your Kraken runs out and you die, your whole team's just fucked.
Yeah, see, that's interesting though, because Umbri has the Rapid Pro, which can kind of fill that role if they do decide to go up really far. Generally though, I prefer the CRB on zones here, just because you can sort of paint the map, paint the zone quite cleanly with the CRB.
Yeah.
But yeah, we see Dank Blues with the control early on. Perhaps the team comp isn't working out.
Yeah, I would also venture that perhaps they are memeing simply because for them this is, you know, an in-house scrim, perhaps. I don't know.
I don't know. I think both teams want to win. My thing, though, is that I feel like... my thing is always with Rapid Pro, I feel like it's a team weapon. Like, it's not a bad weapon by any means. It's very, very strong. But you have to be close to people for it to be very effective. On its own, in a 1v1 situation, it's not the best. So you want to be sure that he's with someone. In that first bush, he just kind of went on his own, and you can see he just got instantly destroyed by the pro. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's an extremely long-range weapon, though. People really underestimate just how far those shots go. Like, where he's standing right now is sort of the little nook with the bridge there. He can actually shoot onto the little half pipe. And it's with the damage up build. I'm not sure he's actually running it. I think he's running subsaver recovery or something like that.
Yeah, I don't think
which is actually
for the full 99.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Usually you go with like 3 damage mains so you can get the 97.5 shot, which is still almost as good. The other thing with 4 mains of damage on the Rapid Pro is that it actually makes Seekers do 100 damage with the sort of middle AoE, where they usually do 80. Actually, not 80, they do more like... actually, no, it is excellent. 80, because... yeah,
Strike Snipe, or Zuka Snipe.
Takes out the E-Leader that clutch Zuka.
Yeah. See, that's sort of the reasoning behind it, is just because Zuka is so strong on Moray, like, you can get those...
so strong on Moray, ridiculous.
It's like a pocket E-Leader almost.
Pretty much,
damn, he gets killed in that zone, that's unfortunate. They should have had that. Okay, and finally Umbra
still
gets
got it.
Push.
Still got
someone
it.
Needs to jump to Umbra just to keep that pressure going. Like,
yeah,
the sniper
can't really get support.
He just keeps moving in deeper.
Umbra not...
he was on deep blue, like, so why not go deep?
Right.
But it's working out. Oh.
Ooh.
Just
damn.
The tip.
Just the tip.
Still like a pretty good control though. You can see the E-Leader's all the way over to the far side, just making sure that the zone doesn't get flanked. But looks as though the push is more or less dead now.
I mean, that's all you can really do as an E-Leader. It's very, very hard to get up in an offensive position without just leaving yourself very open. So all you can really do is just make sure no one flanks or just sit in the mid. Typically in zone, you're pretty boring as an E-Leader because you just kind of make sure no one comes around.
Nades. Oh, they might be getting the zone back here, though. That's a wipe. Actually, they might get the lead off this.
No, that's going to be a lead.
That's for sure the lead.
As you can see, Taylor is going up on the top left, making sure they get that control so they don't hit it.
Oh, no.
Somehow the zone gets taken.
Oh, yep.
All they needed to do was contest the zone there, I think.
Yeah. Oh
just shy.
That's two men down.
Almost.
I mean, they can still get this. 4 seconds left, a minute 30.
Yeah,
they got it.
Penalty and lead.
Three men down.
And a lead. Nice. That's beautiful.
They still got it. Oh,
they just bullied their way. Like, they just were like, through sheer determination and will, were like, we'll get this. I am really loving for Dank's side, though, the choice in doing the soda slosher. I mean, because you've got splat bombs, which are incredibly annoying on this, just with all the little nooks and crannies and corners. And then they've got the Inkzooka. And then you have the benefit of being up on the overlook to just basically dump a tremendous amount of paint down underneath you if you need to just contest and get your zone back, or, you know, if you get up into the overlook to keep control of the enemy's zone as well.
Looks like we're going to have a knockout.
Oh, and the
Danger Zone! I'm watching this on stream, this is my favorite.
Pretty interesting how the Rapid worked out for them there. Sort of didn't get much done, but like he got... See, the funny thing is that the one kill that he got early on with the Zooka was actually one of the key picks that got them into the enemy team zone. So,
definitely.
I mean, the 2-6 scoreline is a bit deceptive there. Like, he opened up the first push, and then his teammates did the rest. Probably could have done better with either a regular Rapid or a CRB or even a Lunar or something like that. He was going to stick with the blaster, but...
I think the range is what let him just kind of fend them off with a long stick. He didn't get a whole lot of kills with it, but just waving it violently in front of their faces kept them away enough.
Sorry about that. Will is looking for a team. It's just 4-0'd. The B team...
Oh, no!
Let me get this.
Yo, what is this collusion in the brackets?
Like, we've got the B movie, mean... but every time Get Kraken says the word fat, it gets faster.
Damn, dude. Yo, that they put that video on YouTube, it'll be over in like 5 minutes or some shit.
I think you're giving him way too much credit for 5 minutes.
I'm lowballing. Yeah, we got the blues teams facing off. We got the meme teams facing off. What's next? Chimera versus Extermination in the first round?
It's pretty intense though. You have Chimera and Hokusai, but you have Tomo and Kairos in the first round. They were the finalists in last DNS.
All right, good. He's gone back to the CRB with the double special saver as well, so we get to see some solid instant Krakens out of spawn. Also going with the sub saver, interestingly enough. I guess normally with this map, of course, everyone just runs a million quick respawn because, well, the map's about 2 feet wide. And
yep, but you cannot.
It's generally conducive
that.
To not losing. Yeah,
we've made it competitive.
I mean,
we made them work harder at it.
It changes. Yeah. It changes this map. The map completely changes.
It does quite
based
a bit.
On how quick respawn. You have to play it way different.
To be fair, like the double saver build is almost, it's sort of like a discount quick respawn in a sense, just because like you have so much like power out of spawn basically. Like you pop out of spawn with a Kraken just ready to go, and like there's not much the enemy team can do about it, especially with Rainmaker, where the special advantage from pushing the objective is ridiculous. Like you just run two saver mains, and by the time you finish your respawn animation, you've already got the Kraken ready to go. So,
yeah, but I'd argue that's good creativity, you know? You're like, damn, I have no invincibility special, let's stack that special saver to try and make sure that I have a Kraken whenever a push is ready for us. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know, I wouldn't say that that's the worst thing in the world, I'd say that's just more being creative with how you want to play your build, right? Oh, especially as Umbra, a defensive player. Yeah. Like, he's always going to have a Kraken up, so it suits his playstyle to do that.
Yeah, I guess my point was more that it's a similar kind of playstyle that it puts you into. With quick respawn, usually the way to play it effectively is not to just suicide in, but to make sort of more aggressive plays. And, well, here we see the casual 2 second push by 60 points.
Yep.
Dang. But, yeah, well, now the push is sort of petering out.
One thing I would say in particular, though, is that even if there was quick respawn, I feel like Umbre would flourish more with this type of build regardless.
Yeah, it's just because so effective on CRB.
His defensiveness that he plays, like, he's not that player that's going to make those aggressive plays that make quick respawn worthwhile. Like, he hasn't really died a lot, but the quick saver makes sure he always has that Kraken available if he does.
Yeah, so, like, you just saw right there, he just suicided the three players. Like, yeah. That's not even necessarily a bad play either. He could have very easily got the direct. The Rainmaker was going up a wall, which means it was very easy to line the shot up on. And instead of, like, worrying about, oh, well, I just lost my Kraken, he's already got his Kraken back. Like, he had his Kraken from the moment he left spawn. And what the Saber build does, as well as the Quick Respawn build, just in a different sort of manner, is just reduces the risk inherent to making those kinds of plays that... Like, if he'd got that kill, he would have just stopped the push dead, and his team wouldn't even have to worry about getting the Rainmaker out of their maze right now.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing, is that, like, you could absolutely see his motivation and, like, what he was wanting to do. He was trying to make the more selfless play and not go for, like, you know, the easy kill, like, for his KD on the Luna and, like, anything else, but he didn't get the kill on the Rainmaker, and he did then also not use his Kraken to get the Rainmaker again and kind of put his team in a slightly compromising situation. So it's like, I think he was wanting to make the right decisions, but he just wasn't making the right plays.
Oh, that bomb! He did it by the whale.
I love those bombs. Those are so satisfying.
You could tell that was a mistake on Dank. Like, he was trying to get up and he got stuck on the wall and the bomb killed him.
That was the disruptor as well.
Yeah, it's great. It's...
Oh, we might be seeing a
push. Near wipe on Dank.
Yeah, but the Rainmaker still gets taken out, but he's a Kraken. Oh, no. What I would have done is I would have popped that Kraken and gone straight for that to pop, get some more time on it.
I mean, it's a little tricky in the position it's in because you sort of got to go uphill and it's
really easy. But if you have the Kraken, you can just kind of glide through it. Like, he should have just popped it instantly. Because now, like, he's back down, there's no push, and yeah, he has a Kraken back up, of course, but it's just... I feel like he's being too cautious with them. Like, he could have had...
He is being very cautious with them, considering how much special saver he's running.
Yeah. And because that's the thing, right, is you run that special saver, and you can just... You don't have to... Like, most weapons with Kraken, you get shot at, and you just pop Kraken because you get forced. With CRB, with special saver, you don't do that. You just let yourself die with the Kraken, and you have it up. Like, they've got 10 seconds left, Umbre's got a Kraken just sort of sitting there ready to go. Even if they happen to kill him, he'll still have another Kraken in overtime. Like, it's... there's not really much that Dank Blues can do about this.
I would like to say that was really smart play by Umbre in particular. He saw the timer going down at 30 seconds. If you notice, instead of pushing up to try and go for that aggressive play, he pulled back and just waited in that zone. He's like, I can stop them before 23, and he just waited with that Kraken. He's like, no matter where you go, I got this.
I love the double double shades.
I was going to say something about that too. Yeah,
you can't run quick respawn. You can run LDE. Yeah.
Just some quick updates. Unknown has 4-0'd Phoenix. Another update is Deep Blues has 4-0'd Dank Blues, which is what we just watched, and Death Star, which is apparently a mix of Extermination and some other people, have just 4-0'd Black Squid Ink Burger.
Yeah, we've actually... I was kind of surprised at how many Euro teams were around. I mean...
Yeah.
Normally the classic thing is, like, Extermination complaining they have to go to bed at 9 o'clock or whatever. But I guess if they hop on a team with a couple of people from cooldown, that sort of solves that problem, I guess.
Actually, the team with cooldown and half Extermination got eliminated.
Oh, okay. Well...
They got a Black Squid Ink Burger beat them back.
Wait, what?
Black Squid Ink Burger beat them in bracket.
I'm looking at 4-0 to Death Star there.
Oh, Death Star is Extermination people and a couple of others, but it's not cooldown.
Right. Okay.
Cooldown and Extermination was Down confused. Nation, which is a very risque name, I would like to say. I don't even know if I would touch that name, but